Lord Taylor of Warwick.
My Lords, I beg to move the motion standing in my name on the order paper. My Lords, a British national newspaper once asked its readers what it means to be British. One of the responses it got was this: being British is about driving in a German car, to an Irish pub, for a Belgian beer, then travelling home, grabbing an Indian curry or Turkish kebab on the way, and then to sit on Swedish furniture and watch American shows on a Japanese TV. And the most British thing of all, suspicion of anything foreign. Now, this is a vivid example, my Lords, of why being British is not defined or explained by narrow national, ethnic or geographical origin. But we need to understand what the concept is in order to adequately face the challenges of modern Britain in a fast-changing world. Now, the question of British identity in the context of its culture, history, constitution and ethical tradition is very topical and important. This is why the issue has been addressed in recent speeches by the Prime Minister, the leaders of the two main opposition parties, and only 2 days ago by the former Attorney General, the noble Lord, Lord Goldsmith. There is a saying, my Lords, we should all choose our parents carefully. Well, for understandable reasons, that advice, although well-intended, is difficult to follow. But in the case of my parents, they had the good sense to ensure that I was born and brought up in a place some regard as paradise. It is arguably one of the most beautiful and exotic spots in the world. It's called Birmingham, just off the M6 motorway by the old gasworks. Now, this link to Birmingham I proudly share with the noble minister. Well, what Birmingham in the 1950s perhaps lacked in scenic beauty, it made up for in its new vitality and diversity. My parents were part of the Windrush generation that came from a genuine paradise, Jamaica in the West Indies. They came from a group of islands in the Caribbean which arguably had a stronger sense of what British meant than those actually born and raised here. My mother's ancestry included Anglo-Irish. My father served as a sergeant in the British 8th Army, otherwise known as the Desert Rats. Amongst his proudest possessions were medals that he won as a result of his part in the Battle of Anzio in Italy during the Second World War. My parents were part of a generation of immigrants who came to Britain with a genuine love, my Lords, for the British flag, British royalty, and British literature. After the war, my father demobbed to Birmingham, in the country he called the Motherland. But to his shock, he quickly found that the streets were more cold than gold. He was immediately asked, "When are you going home to your real home in Jamaica?" You see, he thought he was home. Hope turned to despair when he realized the only job he could get was as a cleaner in the local factory. Now, as a qualified accountant, he had hoped for something a little better. He became further disillusioned when, in looking for a room to rent, he saw sign after sign in house windows stating, "No blacks, no Irish, no dogs." Immigration quickly became a very divisive and emotive issue. People didn't realize that immigration didn't just start in the 1950s. Britain is a nation of immigrants: Danes, Normans, Irish, French, Spanish, Huguenots, Jews, Muslims, Indians, Pakistanis, and Africans. Our food and language is derived from a rich variety of different nations and cultures. Fortunately, my parents and many immigrants like them did not flee in the midst of racism. They chose to stay and make a life for themselves. The fact that my father, Derif Taylor, was also talented enough to sign as a professional cricketer for Warwickshire eventually took him off the factory floor and into the Hall of Fame at the Warwickshire Stadium, where his photograph still remains as a memory of his achievements. But it was only after two seasons, when he had scored 126 runs not out against Leicestershire, that he finally believed that he would never have to clean any more toilets at the Lucas factory. Cricket was not just a sport to him, it was his way out of poverty and racism. In fact, when I was a child, he often used to say to me, "Boy, one day I want to see you at Lord's." Well, I think he meant Lord's cricket ground. Since then, of course, many ethnic minorities in Britain have made themselves icons and role models, in particular in sport and entertainment. And the people like my father and other immigrants have shown that being British can allow you to be valued by your actions, not by your accents. And many descendants of the Windrush generation also experience racism, but they learned the skills to bloom where they were planted. So being British is not defined by racial or geographical origin. It's about national values and hallmarks, my lords. It encompasses the rule of law, parliamentary democracy, social justice, fair play, freedom of speech, and equality of opportunity. Britain created what is the mother of parliaments, and its legal system has been copied around the world by other countries. But, my lords, it could be strongly argued that some of these traditional values have been under attack in recent years. The attempts to curb the right to trial by jury, the restriction of free speech under the Racial and Religious Hatred Bill, and the proposal, my lords, to imprison for 42 days without charge, are seen by many as a serious erosion of British values. Now, the development of the British as multiracial and multicultural is a positive and dynamic thing. My own three children see themselves as typical, proud Londoners, being a mixture of Afro-Caribbean, Polish, Scottish, Russian, Irish and Indian, aren't we all? Now, this multicultural ethos is important and welcome. Diversity and respect for difference is healthy, but over the years, there's developed a regrettable imbalance, my lords, between multiculture and integration. We must remain proud, of course, of our racial and cultural roots, but this must be balanced by an encouragement and a willingness to become integrated within a common British identity. Now, this does not mean, my lords, assimilation. One can be British and Afro-Caribbean. One can be British and Chinese. I have to agree with Sir Trevor Phillips, the head of the Commission for Equality and Human Rights, that Britain is becoming more divided by race and religion. He said, and I quote, "We are sleepwalking our way to segregation. We are becoming strangers to each other." I agree with Sir Trevor's view that we should not put people in boxes which not only separate them, but end up treating them unequally. As he rightly says, this means accepting that people are different, but in some key areas, if you live in a society, you have to play by the rules that we've all agreed upon. Now, the imbalance between multiculture and integration as a policy has led not to cohesion, national unity and a sense of community, but to isolation, alienation and even hostile communities. Research by Policy Exchange found evidence of a rise in Islamic fundamentalism amongst young British Muslims. Almost a third surveyed said they would prefer to live under Sharia law. This is not the way forward, my lords. It produces young adults with multiple identities, with some torn between two versions of themselves. One identity designed to fit in with modern British secular society, but the other feels called by a religious fervour at odds with the modern world around it. This background of hostility culminated in the bombings and attempted bombings we've experienced in Britain in recent years. So this issue is critical and must be addressed. The terrorists seek to rule by the law of force, not by the force of law. But we have to build bridges, not walls, between racial and cultural groups in Britain. It is vital that people from different communities feel a sense of being included as part of the British identity, alongside their other cultural identity. Treating them as monolithic blocks, rather than as equal members of society, has been both divisive and, I would say, patronising. Either we learn to pull together or be pulled apart. So how can we nurture this concept of being British? We have to recognise that Britain has failed to create a sense of national identity embraced by all, regardless of their faith or ethnic origins, in a way, for example, that I believe America has. We need a stronger sense of inclusive identity. The Life in the United Kingdom Advisory Group said, and I quote, "To be British seems to us that we respect the laws, the democratic political structures, and give our allegiance to the state in return for its protection. To be British is to respect those overarching institutions, values, and beliefs that bind us all, the different nations and cultures, together in peace and in legal order. To be British does not mean assimilation into a common culture so that original identities are lost." I am at one with that definition. So in terms of nurturing this sense of what is British, I first of all refer to the English language. We have to have a stronger promotion of the English language. We're very fortunate in Britain that the international language of business, the internet, and popular culture is English. Some of the world's most respected writers, old and new, are British. It is essential that new immigrants learn to speak English so that they can communicate with the rest of society. I can understand the rationale behind the government's multicultural approach, which has led to a growth in the translation of public documents and signs into mother tongue languages. But this has actually undermined integration and cohesion. Secondly, I certainly support the principle of a language and knowledge test, which will equip new migrants with skills and information. The test should be a meaningful proof that the applicants have made a genuine effort to become more aware of British society, but not so onerous as to be an unfair obstacle. The test is comprised of 24 multiple choice questions with a required pass mark of 75%. I had a look at the type of questions that are asked. These are just a couple of examples. What are the roles and powers of the main institutions of Europe? How is European law organised? Well, my lords, after the Irish no vote against the Lisbon Treaty, with the resulting muddle and war of words, I wonder how confidently any of us could answer that question. Another test question for immigrants is this: what are the powers of the devolved administrations? Which areas of policy remained under the control of the UK government? Well, bearing in mind the complexities of the West Lothian question, which no one has come to a full answer, I do not envy immigrants grappling with that question. Now, the education watchdog Ofsted has said that these classes were the worst taught in schools. 25% of classes were not taught in a proper manner to a required standard, or to the required standard. And a survey by the National Foundation for Educational Research revealed that pupils knew less about voting and politics than they did 3 years previously, when these lessons became compulsory. The third is the issue of role models in British society. We hear a lot about young people in the media in a negative context, but there are many young black and Asian and other ethnic minority young men and women who've become icons, especially in the sporting and entertainment industry. We need to focus more on the positives whilst accepting the negatives. The media often has this philosophy: if it bleeds, it leads. So we see on the front page of many newspapers, murders, drugs, knife crime, gun crime. These things are serious problems and need to be addressed. But there are throughout the country many community initiatives which are working well and need government support. I'm the director of the Warwick Leadership Foundation, which is seeking to work with a number of inner city schools where black and ethnic minority role models will be going into the schools to inspire school children of all colours and all backgrounds. Fourthly, there are many faith and voluntary groups that need support, government support at local and national level. They know their communities better than anyone else. I'm talking about the churches, the synagogues, the mosques, the Hindu and Sikh temples. I would like to see government funding of joint initiatives between local faith and community groups. They are the people that know their people best. Now, as far as the government is concerned, it has a job to do in terms of promoting the British concept. But we all have a role to play. There needs to be a dialogue with schools, colleges, faith groups and community groups. My Lords, being British is about shaking hands, not fists. I beg to move the papers. Yeah.